Coffee drinkers, this is what happens when practice time turns into composition time, or practice mode into composition mode. Actually, it's also what happens when you have Chelsea on the couch working on tour posters, which is totally awesome. And I don't get to see them just yet. Like, we're sitting on opposite ends of the couch, and I kind of made a joke that I was going to stand up and practice and do a silly dance, which I did, and which neither of us, thankfully for everyone, neither of us got that on camera.
Sorry.
She's not sorry. She was like reaching for the cell phone as soon as I started doing the stupid dance. But now I'm actually sitting on the couch. She claims that it helps her concentrate. Oh, I don't know if she actually likes to listen to it. No idea why. But once I got past the scales and the, you know, the little maintenance thing, I started playing chords and I started really turning practice time into composition time. And so far, let's see if I can remember this thing here. What I like about this, I should have put it in the looper as I was playing it for you there, but I will explain what I like about it right after I put a loop in. Okay, so G over B, B flat 6. E flat triad to F triad, and then F over A to G minor, root, first inversion, second inversion, first inversion, and back to the top. And what I like is that change, where in kind of like G minor, this kind of sound, God, the intonation is so gone on this bass. Yeah, it's wow, that wasn't quite in shot, but what Chelsea just did was really give me like a dirty look, because the bass is so out of tune. And then she leant over and switched on the tuner as I was playing. I wish that had been in shot. It's driving Chelsea up the wall. And actually the bass was in tune. So it's the, yeah, and now she's just giving me that kind of look. It's actually the intonation that's not doing so good. Oh, that's so crusty. Actually, I should sharpen that a little bit. Anyway, what I like about this chord sequence, to get back to this idea, is that it's going from this G minor sound at the end of the loop to G major. And I love that B flat going to B natural, like that, the third essentially going from minor to major. That's a really, it's a really nice color. That's something I enjoy improvising over and really kind of accentuating. I'll play over it and show you kind of how that sounds. Going to end up being a composition, but it happens as quickly as that. I started off with a melody earlier on, something like that, but out of that I got the chords. So actually this was a case where the melody came first, and then I harmonized actually, because it was just the melody. I harmonized the melody, then kind of reharmonized the melody a little bit, then got rid of the melody and ended up with these chords. And there are so many things I could do with these chords now as well. Now that I have the basic framework, the basic layout, I could actually change the inversion of them. So this is G, but I'm starting off in the first inversion for the sequence. I could easily go, instead of, I could also go, and the other option is, that's going from the root position to the next chord, which is like a B flat 6. The other option, instead of going from first inversion to the B flat, is to go from second inversion, very different color there. Don't think I really favor that one at all. It definitely, for my ear, be between and this one. And it's, I mean, I guess this is kind of in my head because I'm putting all these like conceptual ideas into the core book. It's not just like, here are a bunch of voicings, good luck. It's like, well, here are some voicings, but here's how you create voicings. And then really, ultimately, the goal, at least it is for me anyway, here's how you use those. And here's how you bolster your vocabulary with them. And you expand your language and your ability to write and to have a unique voice and to really be identifiable as you. I think that's, for me anyway, that's always been the most important goal. So I'd be interested actually to hear what your feedback is on that. Leave me some comments below the video. Like, what is your goal when you're adding something new to your repertoire or to your vocabulary, a new lick or a new idea, a new phrase, a new sequence of notes? How do you think about that? Are you thinking conceptually? Are you thinking, okay, I'm adding this in there, I'm going to play it in all keys, I'm going to develop it, I'm going to turn it into something of my own? Or is it something that you put in the vocabulary and it just comes out the same way each time? Like, what is your train of thought when it comes to adding any kind of vocabulary? Bass lines, solos, melodies, chords, whatever it is. What is your thought process when you do that for yourself? Because of course I know what it is for me. It's trying to find that unique voice. It's being identified for note selection, especially when it comes to composition. You know, there are now certain tunes that are, you know, slightly more popular than some others that I've written that I'm kind of becoming a little more known for, and people will start to request those on gigs. There start to be more covers of certain tunes on YouTube that people kind of gravitate a little bit more towards. And that's always the sign of, like, for me, moving in the right direction, in that I'm doing something that connects with people and I'm doing something that is unique enough for people to go, oh, okay, that's Janek. So how is that for you? Like, I'm really curious. What connection do you have with your audience with that? Is it a tune? Is it a lick you play? Is it a sound? Is it a pedal? Is it an instrument? Is it like, I don't know, very, very curious. I'd love to hear your feedback on that. Boy, the intonation on this instrument is driving me nuts. I'll be right back. Remember this one? I barely do. Output is a little less on it. That I noticed that immediately. Strings are old as hell, and they're like half wound as well, like cross between round wounds and flat wounds, so they make a little bit of a different sound. Have a little bit. Wow, so different, and the action is so low. Oh my God, look at this. The action is low. I still have the ramp in. I have to tear this ramp out for sure. If I ever play this bass again. And the tone production is just like this compared to the high action. You know, not only is the action tiny, but the tone production, the abilities of tone production on this bass are pretty small as well compared to how I have the action set up on the other Fodera. But hey, it's a Fodera, what am I? I can still fly around it, I guess. Well, that stuff sounds... I really have to take some lessons or something from a flamenco guitar player. I really want to work on that technique where it's like this push down with the nail. There must be like a bunch of combinations in terms of fingerings and plucks and hammer-ons and pull-offs and stuff like that. Yeah, so kind of a little bit like that. Interesting sound. It's also a lot harder to play with the super low action. And this did end up becoming like a backup bass, you know, because it is very, very similar in terms of the build and the body. I'm just wondering if I could actually play one of my tunes, if I really had to, you know? Wow, it's really weird. Like, I don't know if the camera's picking that up as much as I'm hearing it here, but my fingers like hitting the pickup and hitting the ramp as well, making so much noise. It's just right there. There's no kind of follow through. I think that's the big difference I noticed between this bass and the old bass in the way they're set up. I'm kind of curious to set this one up super high like I have the other one and see how playable it would be. That would be really, really interesting. Maybe put some new strings on it as well. Maybe that's a project for this week if Chelsea will let me. She's giving me the sad face because she really likes playing this bass with the kind of dead sounding strings and the low action. And I kind of feel like my calluses would die as well if I played on these kind of strings all the time because they're so smooth. And actually, I don't feel like I can play faster on here. It feels like it's hindered a little bit. Really doesn't. If I were to practice some, and it is really clicky because of the low action. Not a fan of that at all. I would have to really change my touch on the right hand, make it way lighter, which I guess is what I used to have. It was like a super, super light touch and not so much of a range of motion with the right hand. Wow. Well, today's vlog started out one way, went in a completely different direction, and is actually, for me anyway, I hope you guys dig it, whatever, but for me it's very educational in terms of the difference between these two instruments, as similar as they are. And for as long as I played this, you know, what did I play this for, like 8 or 9 years or something before I got the other bass? So I put in some miles and did tons of tours with it. Jury's out. I will, though, put the action up and put a new set of strings on it, put some Dunlop Super Brights on it, and see how it feels. It'll be very, yeah, maybe I'll play it on a tour. Who knows? I'm actually quite curious about it again. And seeing as the intonation's so jacked up on the other one, maybe I'll shoot the whole chord book DVD on this one if I can't get that one set up in time. But yeah, thanks for hanging on today's vlog. Today's vlog is done. I'm gonna spend a little more time with this old friend, I guess. Try and find some chords. I had a that's a pretty way to end. Okay, today's vlog definitely done, and I will see you guys tomorrow.